Hello, I'm Penny Platts, and this is a virtual presentation so that you can watch it as if you were with your group, although only in spirit rather than in fact. I'm going to take you far, far away to the River Mississippi, and we're going to travel on a riverboat from New Orleans to Memphis. It came as a surprise to me that New Orleans is about 100 miles from the coast. The port was founded on a bend in the river in a mosquito-infested swamp with frequent yellow fever outbreaks. So this city has a long multi-race, multicultural history. In the old quarters, the buildings are Creole style or French colonial style, a blend of French, Spanish and Caribbean influences that developed to deal with the hot, humid climate here. You can hear bands everywhere. This is the famous Bourbon Street, named for the French royal family and not the amber-coloured alcohol bourbon, which is a type of American whiskey. This is Bourbon Street during the two-week Mardi Gras, literally Fat Tuesday festival, our Shrove Tuesday. Because of the low-lying ground, the water table's high, and the early French settlers had a problem with the dead floating to the surface, so cemeteries like this were created. This is the famous open-air French market. New Orleans is the most haunted city in the United States, with a rich paranormal history like no other. The French Quarter, the oldest neighborhood, has a history of New Orleans voodoo, a brand of spiritualism during the 18th and 19th centuries. The food here is extraordinary. Pulled pork and roast beef debris. Alligator tail meat is another delicacy. The po' boy is a sandwich with both fried shrimp and fried oysters or roast beef. That looks like scampi, but it's alligator meat, which can only be legally sourced from alligator farms. The po' boy makes your mouth water just to look at it. For a French-style breakfast, try these beignets with icing sugar on top, made from deep-fried choux pastry, prepared fresh and eaten hot, just delicious with coffee. This is how I imagined this area, oak trees hung with Spanish moss. Actually, the plant's part of the bromeliad family and nothing to do with moss, it's related to the pineapple. Hurricane Katrina landed on the 23rd of August 2005 until the 31st of August. It caused $125 billion of damage, killed over 1,000 people and flooded more than 80% of the city, with some parts under 15 feet of water. At last we're on Old Man River, the Great Mississippi. Here's our transport, the Queen of the Mississippi. The paddle wheel just rotates with the movement of the water. The first traditional steamboat sailed in 1811. Even as early as the 1830s, they had some competition from railroads, although there were only 23 miles of track. But by 1880, there were 93,000 miles of tracks, and the trains took away the steamboat business. Samuel Clemens grew up on the banks of the Mississippi near Hannibal, Missouri. During his time as a pilot, he picked up the term Mark Twain, a call noting that the river was only 2 fathoms deep, the minimum depth for safe navigation. We are greeted here by the impressive double row of 28 giant live oak trees planted before the house was built in 1837. It was originally a sugarcane plantation. After the outbreak of sugarcane virus in 1900, the plantation fell into decline. In 1925, Josephine and Andrew Stewart, both from Texas, purchased it for $50,000 and spent double that in renovations. Mrs. Stewart died on October the 3rd, 1972 at 7:30 in the morning, and all the clocks in the house are stopped on the anniversary of that day to honour her memory. When the Jesuit priests first brought sugarcane to Louisiana in 1751, little did they know they were laying the foundation for an industry that contributes $2 billion to the Louisiana economy. These kettles were used for evaporation. Sugar was a huge moneymaker, so to produce it, the population of slaves soared in just a 20-year period to 125,000. The slave community at Oak Alley fluctuated between 110 and 120 men, women and children. There are cabins here giving an insight into their lives and habits. Cotton was fairly easy to grow, although bad weather and insects could destroy the crop, but it was not profitable as the labourers had to take the seeds out by hand. On a typical plantation, slaves worked 10 or more hours a day from day clean to first dark, 6 days a week, with only the Sabbath off. The revolution came with the cotton gin, which Eli Whitney invented in 1793. Gin just means engine, and it quickly and easily separates cotton fibres from seeds, and so it speeded up the process. This is the largest wetland and swamp in the whole United States. Mangroves can grow in salt or brackish water, and they prevent erosion and protect against storm surges. This is the American alligator, Alligator mississippiensis. As you see, it takes one single drop of water 90 days to travel the entire 2,350 miles from Lake Itasca in Minnesota to the Gulf of Mexico. After World War II, towboats and barges brought new prosperity to cargo transport. They are cabled together into a tow, sometimes longer than three football fields. Vicksburg was founded by a Methodist minister, Newitt Vick, who came from Virginia in about 1814. Sadly, he and his wife died of the deadly yellow fever only 5 years later, leaving 13 children. Here we are on the waterfront in Vicksburg with this stunning collection of murals. An Atlanta pharmacist, John S. Pemberton, created a temperance soft drink that could be sold at soda fountains. He used extracts from the cocoa leaf, so it did have cocaine in it until 1929, and the cola part is from cola nuts that were full of caffeine. Biedenhahn put it in bottles, changing the whole soft drink industry. You can't visit Vicksburg without learning about its pivotal role in the Civil War, fought between the states of the Union and the 11 Confederate states. It began as a fundamental disagreement about slavery. Abraham Lincoln understood the importance of Vicksburg, and he said, "Vicksburg is the key. The war can never be brought to a close until that key is in our pocket." Gaining control of the Mississippi River at the Siege of Vicksburg was key to the Union winning the Civil War. At Gettysburg on the same day, the Confederate Army was defeated. This is the Shirley House, where Union troops dug in and created bomb-proof shelters to protect themselves from Confederate artillery fire. This peaceful scene gives no idea of the toll of war. Over 100,000 soldiers fought here, and 30,000 Confederate troops were captured. This is the African American monument, showing a field hand and one soldier supporting another soldier between them. It represents the sacrifice made by black soldiers on the field of battle during the Civil War. Vicksburg Cemetery holds the remains of 17,000 Civil War Union soldiers. Named for its Egyptian sister on the Nile, Memphis was founded in 1819 and became a transportation centre for the large quantities of cotton. Sun Studios is one of the most famous recording studios in the world. On December the 4th, 1956, the so-called Million Dollar Quartet impromptu jam session took place at Sun Studios in Memphis with Elvis Presley, Jerry Lee Lewis, Johnny Cash and Carl Perkins. Elvis paid $3.98 to make his first recording in 1953 for his mom. The rest is history. He purchased Graceland in March 1957. This was a farm built for the Toof family. The name of the Highway 51 South was changed to Elvis Presley Boulevard in 1971. Love me. No one is allowed to visit upstairs. The most famous room in the house here is built to serve as a den, and it became known as the jungle room because of its furnishings and the built-in waterfall on the north wall. More than 1 billion Elvis Presley records have been sold worldwide. Even in this era of streaming, there have been 164 million plays. His first pink Cadillac went up in smoke. This was the second. Rumor has it that Elvis bought over 200 Cadillacs and most were given away. When he died, fans like me had lost the music of their youth. To us, he was the king of rock and roll. This is built around the former Lorraine Motel, where civil rights leader Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated in 1968 by James Earl Ray. The news of his murder echoed round the world, especially as he had promoted non-violent protest. In August 1963, he'd spoken before 250,000 people from the steps of the Lincoln Memorial on the National Mall in Washington, D.C.
I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
Just moments before his death, they were out on the balcony. 2 months later, Ray was captured at Heathrow Airport trying to leave on a false Canadian passport. He was charged with murder but recanted his confession 3 days later. Allegations that he'd been framed or acted with government agents persisted for decades. For over 150 years, Beale Street has hosted blues music and entertainment. Here is the view we had of nighttime Memphis from our hotel room. The extra special residents at the Peabody are the ducks. The custom dates back to the 1930s when the general manager and his friends returned from a weekend hunting trip in Arkansas. They put their live decoy ducks in the hotel fountain. The guests loved the idea, and since then, every day the ducks travel down in the lift from the roof, walk up the red carpet and swim in the fountain. The sun setting here on Memphis and the great Mississippi River. I hope you've enjoyed your trip.